بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. We continue the explanation of the book of Tawheed, which is the beneficial saying on the book of Tawheed, and we are finishing chapter 15 today, inshallah. This chapter, there are several issues in this chapter which we touched in the discussion of last time. First, the explanation of the two verses in Surah Al-A'raf. The explanation of the two verses in Surah Al-A'raf, and these two verses were 7, 191 and 192. The explanation of the meaning of these verses. قال الله تعالى أيشركون ما لا يخلق شيئا وهم يخلقون ولا يستطيعون لهم نصرا. Do they attribute as partners to Allah those who created nothing, but they themselves are created? No help can they give them, nor can they help themselves. Also, we explained ayat verse 13 of Surah Fatir. Verse 13 of Surah Fatir. قوله تعالى والذين تدعون من دونه ما يملكون من قطمير. And those whom you invoke or call upon instead of Allah, of him, on not even a qitmir, which is the thin membrane over the date stone. Those were explained in the previous part. Also, what was explained is the story of the Battle of Uhud and the injury that took place with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when he was injured in that. And then the third matter which we will discuss tonight is the qunut of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The qunut, and with him were the leaders of the awliya making ta'meen in the salah upon the dua of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And these were the companions. Why did he mention this, the author? He mentioned that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم stood in supplication, supplicating Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and behind him were the leaders of the awliya, يؤمنون في الصلاة, making ta'meen. Why did he mention this? Is he mentioning it just like being a matter of fiqh? No. In his wording, there is a benefit. When he said concerning the companions, he described them sadatul awwalin, the leaders of the awliya, the leaders of the awliya, the leaders of the pious and righteous, of the slaves of Allah. So he intended to tell us that no one of this ummah is more close to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than his companions. Yet despite that, they resorted to Allah concerning times of difficulty and times of hardship. So if this is the case of the best of the believers, the leaders of the believers, the companions, so then how is it that some people resort to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to relieve them from afflictions and calamities and so forth? This is what the author intended in his statement concerning the qunut, the supplication of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while standing, and the leaders of the righteous behind him, meaning the companions. So they did not resort to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, but rather to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the purity of tawheed. This is the purity of singling Allah alone in worship. So how about the case with those who are not as close as the companions? Then by all means, they should take heed and cease from asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the absent, or the angels, or the dead, to relieve them. And they should direct that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the next matter which the author, or the next issue which the author brought, أن المدعو عليهم كفار, meaning those against whom the invocation was made were kuffar. But this is obvious from the verses and the hadith we discussed last time. But why did the author put it in this word, أن المدعو عليهم كفار, when it is obvious that those against whom the dua was made were kafirs, were disbelievers? Why did he say this? Why he did it make it a title for this issue, that they were kuffar? This is evidence that although the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, although he saw that his dua against them is true, Allah pointed to him that this is not his decision. This is not his decision. And even though they were kafirs, so the author is not telling us that they are kafirs. It is known that Safwan bin Umayyah and Suhail bin Amr and Al-Harith bin Hisham, when the dua was made against them, they were kafirs. This is obvious. This is known. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pointed to him that this matter is not for your decision. The fifth issue, that they, those kuffar against whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invoked Allah, that he invoked Allah against them, they did things which were not done by most of the kafirs, were terrible things. In addition to them being disbelievers, they were transgressors. Yet despite that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ, the matter is not for your decision. Otherwise, they injured the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and mutilated the Muslims, the believers, the companions who died in the Battle of Uhud, like Hamza bin Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And yes, they were keen to kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. Yet they are close in kinship, and from them were also the Ansar, the helpers. Yet despite all of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ, the matter is not for your decision. The sixth issue, that Allah revealed this verse which we just cited, لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ, the matter is not for your decision. So with all these matters concerning these kafirs and their transgression and so forth, which may necessitate that the Prophet ﷺ may have the right to invoke Allah against them, Allah revealed this verse, لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ. So the matter solely belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, If this is the case with the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, then by all means it should apply to others. In this verse also, the seventh issue is his saying, Allah saying, أَوْ يَتُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ أَوْ يُعَذِّبَهُمْ, whether he turns in mercy to them and pardons them or punishes them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pardoned them and they believed. And this is dalil, evidence for the perfect authority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his ability. So those people who did what they did from the terrible things against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believers, they believed. They became believers. That is because what? The matter is solely in Allah's hands. He is the one who raises in honor and in might. And he is the one who disgraces whom he wishes in accordance with his wisdom and his justice. And from that what occurred with Umar, as we know, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, before his Islam, we know of his clear opposition to Islam before, and his enmity towards Islam, that was apparent. And then we know what took place and what occurred after his Islam, from protection and guardianship of Islam and giving victory to Islam and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen. So therefore, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and those who are lesser in rank cannot change anything related to the decisions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that clear? The meaning of these verses and these benefits. The eighth issue which the author brought is القنوط في النوازل. قنوط, supplication and standing during or upon afflictions and calamities when they befall people. So when this occurs, the Muslims should invoke Allah until this matter is, until it ceases. This qunut, this dua in standing, is legalized in all the prayers, as in the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, which is reported by Imam Ahmad and others. However, the scholars, rahimahumullah, excluded the plague, at-ta'un. They excluded the befalling calamity of plague. And they said, with respect to that, there should be no qunut, because there is no evidence supporting this. And it occurred during the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, as affirmed in Sahih al-Bukhari and in Sahih Muslim. And he, Umar, did not make qunut, did not stand up in supplicating Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to relieve the ummah then from the plague. And also because it is a shahada, martyrdom, dying due to the plague is a shahada, is a martyrdom. So the person should not invoke Allah to lift it because of the shahada. It is a cause for shahada, for martyrdom. And what is apparent from the sunnah is that the qunut, the dua invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala standing, in the Salah. It is that it is legal in when afflictions and calamities occur by creation, or like, for example, the harming of Muslims and restriction, the afflictions of restriction befalling them. But if it is from the action of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning then in that case what is legalized is what came in the sunnah, like the eclipse. So there is a legalized salah special when the eclipse occurs. Also with earthquakes, the Salat al-Kusuf is legalized at the time of earthquakes, as Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma did, and he said hadhihi salatul ayat, this is the salah of signs. Also when there is drought, then it's legalized to make istisqa, asking Allah, invoking Allah for rain, the salah of istisqa, and so forth. And our Shaykh rahimahullah, he said, I did not come up till this moment, I did not know that qunut is prescribed regarding a matter which befalls by Allah's decree. But rather, the usual dua, the invocations that are particular, are the ones to be mentioned when such a matter befalls from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, if there is this restriction upon Muslims and harm and so forth, then there could be qunut following the sunnah in this matter. So as now the question is, who is to make the qunut? Is he the greater imam, meaning the head of the state, or the imam of the masjid, or any musalli, any person praying? Some of the scholars are with the opinion that the one who makes the qunut is al-imam al-a'zam, the greater imam, who is the head of the state. The other opinion is that every imam may, any imam of a masjid may perform the qunut. And the third opinion is that any person, praying person, can make the qunut. And this is the correct opinion. And is the correct opinion. Why? Because of the general evidence in the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي, pray as you have seen me praying. And this covers the qunut of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the times of calamities and afflictions. The ninth issue and benefit is that it is permissible to name the persons invoked against, to specify their names in the Salah, mention them by names, the names of their fathers. Like in this case, Safwan bin Umayyah, Suhail bin Amr, Al-Harith bin Hisham. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam named them by name, specified them, specified their fathers. This is permissible. So So therefore, if there is a benefit in specifying the name, then naming him is permissible and takes precedence. And if a person invokes Allah for another person or other persons specifically in the salah, mentions them, it is permissible, because this is not considered from the ordinary talk of people. It is a dua, it is an invocation, and the dua is addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, calling upon him. And this does not fall in the meaning of the hadith, إن هذه الصلاة لا يصلح فيها شيء من كلام الناس. This salah is not fit for the common talk of people to be said in it. Question: was the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم then forbidden to make du'a against those mentioned, or he was forbidden to make specific cursing in person? The answer: the forbiddance was related to curse the kafirs in the dua in name, in person. However, cursing them in general, there is no harm in that. And it is affirmed from Abi Hurayra رضي الله عنه أنه كان يقنط, that he used to make qunut, ويلعن الكفرة, and would make curse upon the kafirs in general, عموما. And there is no harm in making dua against the kafir by saying, اللهم أرح المسلمين منه, oh Allah, relieve the Muslims from him, وَكْفِهِمْ شَرَّهُ, and protect them against his evil, and so forth. However, the dua to destroy the entire kafirs, the entire disbelievers, then this requires study and thought and examination. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ did not make dua to have complete annihilation upon Quraysh, upon the Quraysh kafirs. But rather he said in the dua, Allahumma alayka bihim, Allahumma aj'alha alayhim sinina ka sini Yusuf. In the hadith reported in Bukhari and Muslim, the dua was, O Allah, afflict them with 7 famines, as was done in the case of Yusuf. And this is a dua of restriction and distress to befall them. And this could be in the benefit of the oppressor, such that he may refrain and return to Allah and cease his oppression. I will repeat. What's important is that the Shaykh rahimahullah added is that making dua of having complete annihilation of the kafirs, he said, I am hesitant about it. And he said some may take as evidence, and it, you know, the dua of Khubayb, Allahumma ahsihim adada wa la tubqi minhum ahada, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma enumerate them but don't leave anyone of them. Some may take this hadith from the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, which is in Bukhari and Muslim, as a permissibility to make such a dua against them. That is because it occurred at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and that also because the matter ended up as the invoker invoked, meaning Allah answered. So there was no one from them alive at the end of the year. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not deny this. Neither it was denied by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, the response by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to this dua indicates that he was pleased with it and he attested to that and permitted it. This may be taken, he said, the Shaykh rahimahullah, may be taken to make dua against the kafir for total annihilation. However, one should re-examine and study the story itself. There could be specific causes which may not occur under every situation. Also, the dua then of annihilation was to a limited group of the kafirs. It was not for all the kafirs then. Also, there is, if the hadith is authentic, the hadith of dua of Utbah bin Abi Lahab. Utbah bin Abi Lahab once, he harmed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and once he approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and most defiantly and brazenly shouted at him, and he said, "I disbelieve in," and he recited 53:1, "by the star when it goes down," the meaning. And also he said, "I disbelieve in," and he recited 53:8, which means that he, Jibreel, approached and came closer, meaning that I don't believe in any of the Quran. He then started to deal high-handedly with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and laid violent hand on him, tore his shirt and spat into his face, but his saliva missed the holy face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He missed the face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thereupon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam invoked Allah's wrath on Utbah, and supplicated, "Allahumma sallit alayhi kalban min kilabik." O Allah, set one of your dogs on him. Set one of your dogs on him. Allah responded to the Prophet's supplication, and it happened once Utaybah was with some of his compatriots from Quraysh, set out for Syria and took the Greater Sham, and they came to the city in the Greater Sham area known as Zarqa, and then a lion came and started sniffing the people then. And then he came directly to Utbah, and then finally came to Utbah, who at once recalled the Prophet ﷺ words in supplication and said, "Woe to my brother, this lion will surely devour me," just as Muhammad ﷺ supplicated, and he was killed by the lion. And he said, "He has yani really killed me in the greater Syria area, greater Sham, in the greater Syria area, while he is in Mecca, while he, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is in Mecca." And this lion, it said in his story that he rushed like lightning and snatched Utbah from amongst the people and crushed his head. This is reported by Ibn Asakir in his biography of Utbah bin Abi Lahab. And it is reported by Al-Hakim also, and he said that its isnad is sahih. The Imam al-Dhahabi agreed to Al-Hakim's statement, and Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar graded it as hasan, graded the hadith, "Allahumma sallit alayhi kalban min kilabik," Allah set one of your dogs on him as Hadith al-Hasan. So if this hadith is authentic, then there is dalil, there is evidence to make dua to destroy a particular kafir, but not upon the whole kafirs. The tenth issue. The author, rahimahullah, said, لعن المعين في القنوط, cursing a particular person in قنوط, in the supplication of the قنوط. Our Shaykh rahimahullah commented about this and he said, this is strange. If the author, rahimahullah, intended that this matter took place, then it was forbidden, then there is no problem with that. But if he intended from this statement he made that it is permissible to curse the particular person in qunut as to be norm, then this is a matter that needs to be examined, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade that. The tenth issue, the story when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commanded by Allah azza wa jal to warn those close in relation to him, in the hadith concerning the verse, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, and warn your tribe of near kindred, or Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That when it was revealed, he, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, stood up and said, and we explained this last time, he stood up and said, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh, O people of Quraysh, save your souls, or a similar, or something similar, save your souls. اشتروا أنفسكم لا أغني عنكم من الله شيئا, I possess nothing with which to protect you from Allah. يا عباس بن عبد المطلب, O Abbas, son of عبد المطلب, I possess nothing with which to protect you from Allah. يا صفية عمة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, O Safiya, aunt of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, Messenger of Allah, I possess nothing with which to protect you from Allah. ويا فاطمة بنت محمد, and O Fatima, daughter of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, سليني من مالي ما شئت لا أغني عنك من الله شيئا, ask me of what I have anything you wish, I possess nothing with which to protect you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, ask me of what I have anything you wish from my property, I will not prevent you. Here, because in this case, it is his property and he possesses his property. However, with respect to the right of Allah, he said, لا أغني عنك من الله شيئا, I possess nothing with which to protect you from Allah. So in this case, he generalized, he responded to the command of Allah to warn those of near kindred, so he went openly and called Quraysh in general, then those who are closer to him in relation, alayhi salatu wasalam. The 12th point or issue, the Prophet's seriousness regarding this affair, this matter, to the extent that this was the a cause taken, or a text, a pretext taken by the pagans to attribute insanity to him. You know, they said, well, because he was so serious, they said, well, something happened to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He went insane. How could he gather us and then invite us in this manner? Oh Quraysh, oh such and such. And similarly, the author said, it is the case if it is done by a Muslim nowadays. Meaning if a person now gathers the people and say and stands warning them, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned before, they will say he is majnoon, he is insane. Unless people, يعني إلا إذا كان معتادا عند الناس, if this is something which he normally does with people. And indeed, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al Imran, chapter 3, verse 140, وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ, chapter 3, verse 140, and so are the days we give to men by turns. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, يُقَلِّبُ اللَّهُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ, Allah turns the day and the night. So this may differ with respect to certain countries and certain times. However, the person should exert the effort in the da'wah to Allah in a wise way and giving good admonition. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam did this, and he did not give attention as to him being called insane and other labels. The 13th issue brought by the author, rahimahullah, is the mentioning of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in this call to his relatives and his people, لا أغني عنك من الله شيئا ولا أغني عنك يا فاطمة بنت محمد لا أغني عنك من الله شيئا. I possess nothing which to protect you from Allah, and O daughter, O Fatima bint Muhammad, I possess nothing with which to protect you from Allah. So if this is a matter which is explicitly stated by the leader and the best of all the messengers, that he himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, possesses nothing with which to protect from Allah, from whom? Protect the best of women, Fatima bint Muhammad. And if the person believes this, and we believe that that this is the case, you know, because this is what he said, then it becomes clear to us that what is done by some people nowadays, it becomes clear that they had abandoned Tawheed, and it shows the strangeness of the deen. That is because there exist some people who think of themselves as scholars, and seen by others around them that they are ulama, that they are scholars and fit to be imitated. They invoke the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to relieve them from harm and also to bring them benefits or toward of harm. Explicitly they state that, and they reiterate, as in the poem, the infamous poem, يَا أَكْرَمَ الْخَلْقِ مَالِي مَنْ أَلُوذُ بِهِ, O most honorable of the creation, who else I should return and seek refuge in, سِوَاكَ, only you, عِنْدَ حُلُولِ الْحَادِثِ الْعَمَمِ, upon the occurrence of a great calamity. And other statements from this type of shirk. And this is something which the mystics had turned into a song known as Nahj al-Burda, so widespread even by so-called scholars, and people imitate them on this. And they have bands nowadays, special bands which sing this shirk song. And if they are admonished or denounced on this action, they will respond and say, this is evidence that you don't know the right of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his rank with Allah, and that he is the leader and of the universe, and jinn and ins were created only for him. And that he was created from the light of the arsh. And so they deceive the common Muslims. And people believe them because of their ignorance. And if someone comes and invites them to Tawheed, to single Allah alone, in worship, have pure Islam, they don't respond. That is because their leader and their scholar is in opposition to Tawheed, having a stance opposing this. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in Surah Al-Baqarah 2:145, وَلَئِنْ أَتَيْتَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ بِكُلِّ آيَةٍ مَا تَبِعُوا قِبْلَتَكَ. And even if you were to bring to the people of the scripture all the verses, all the signs, they would not follow your qibla. Yeah. In addition, we know that the emotion of the Muslim and his inclination towards the Messenger is a matter that is not to be denounced. However, meaning his love and his emotion towards his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the person must not make the emotion to be the judge and the rule, but rather he should follow what is proven by the book and the sunnah, and which is supported by the sound intellect, free from shahawat and shubuhat, free from unclear and ambiguous things, and also lowly desires. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala denounced the kafirs who followed the traditions of their forefathers, that they لا يعقلون. They don't contemplate. They don't have sound minds and contemplation. And therefore, what the author rahimahullah said is true. Because if someone really contemplates the status of the people in many of the Islamic countries, it becomes clear to him that Tawheed is abandoned and that the Deen is strange. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to change the affair of the Muslims into a better one by making them mindful of Tawheed and making the truth prevailing. Alhamdulillah, الذي بنعمته تتم الصالحات وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.